This is Hard Rockology. There's a little 17 from Kingdom Come's debut album. And on the phone, we're currently talking with Lenny Wolf, lead singer.
Yes, I'm still here.
Yeah, he's still here. So, yes, Lenny
thanks,
Wolf.
Thanks for having me here, Matt. Thank you.
Yeah, so Lenny's still there. And in the last segment, Len, we had an opportunity to talk about Stone Fury and basically how that band came together and inevitably how that band basically fell apart. So why don't we talk about the transition from Stone Fury to, I guess, the very first Kingdom Come and how Kingdom Come came together?
Yes, let me take a step back a little while. I mean, as I was mentioning earlier on, I don't remember how we got. But after the second Stone Fury basically flopped, I mean, it was a well-paid experience, that's what I call it, but it just wasn't meant to be. MCA dropped the ball on us, and Bruce and I realized, you know, it was a great time, but it didn't really function. So I was hiding back in my hall at my manager's wonderful house, just writing. He was feeding me and allowing me to use his BMW to, like, at least have a few dates in the meantime, so I could, like, you know, take care of my sanity. So, and then after I wrote, I don't know, four, five, six songs with my four-track Tascam demo machine. God, the good old days. It makes me crack up. He just took those tapes and were shopping my demos. But basically the whole record industry passed on it, mainly because maybe the demos were sounding lousy, which they certainly did. I mean, it certainly took a lot of imagination to see what the potential could be. And the other reason probably was that Stone Fury didn't work out at all. So maybe the record companies were kind of scared, like, to take on that risk. But whatever, there was a guy called Derek Schulman. He was the head of A&R from Polygram Records in New York. And he was actually a singer himself from Gentle Giant, like, I don't know, many, many moons ago. And he signed Cinderella and Bon Jovi just a couple of years before he signed us. So, and he met, him and I, we met and we were talking, blah, blah, blah. And he really dug my voice and the songs. But he said, Lenny, you really got to find great guys and put a band together. And I said, it sounds great, Derek. That's exactly what I wanted to do. I don't want to be a solo artist. I don't want to be the main cheese. I want to be with a band. Oop, that bing, that was just my Mac sending an email, I'm sorry. And so there I was flying back to LA and looking for bandmates. So I was just through a friend of mine, her name was Lucy Forbes. She was running a so-called musician agency, just hooking up musicians who were looking for a job or looking for bands or looking for whatever. And so she was helping me lining up musicians. And that's how I met James, Danny, Johnny, and Rick. And there were lots of great drummers passing through, but James, he had that feel. He was that charming, great Bonham kind of Kentucky dude who was delivering exactly what I was hoping for. And his best friend back then, actually still until today, because James and I are still in touch, was Rick Steyer, because they both grew up in Kentucky. So he introduced Rick Steyer, who played a cool rhythm guitar. So he took on the rhythm guitar part. And then came along Denny Stagg, and he really impressed me by his tone. He was heavily into Hendrix. I mean, he was looking like him, and he was actually talking a bit too much like him, I guess, but he sounded fantastic. He had this wonderful particular tone. And speaking of tone, that's, you know, it's very hard to find. I mean, you have a lot of great guitar players, but if you're talking tone, we're talking Jimmy Page, Angus Young, what's his name here? God, there's so many out there. Eric Clapton, or whatever. I mean, like guitar player with a very David Gilmour. Oh God, he's just God. So I mean, guitar players with a tone. So Denny really nailed it, and I think Denny had a lot to do with the song "What Love Can Be," which is relying a lot on the bluesy feel to become as successful as it did by his playing. So he certainly made a difference there.
Well, let's take a step back because you mentioned Danny and his different influences, and I'm going to bring this up, and I never thought it was just the criticisms that Kingdom Come got in regards to being like a Zeppelin clone and all that. So I'm just going to throw that out there. I never heard that when I listened to Kingdom Come. Yeah, I heard elements that were plucked here and there that were incorporated into the sound. But you mentioned Jimi Hendrix, Clapton, and all these other guitar players. And when you listen to his guitar playing, that's exactly what you get. It's a style. It's a tone. And for me, that's what I got out of Kingdom Come when I heard that first album. And I just want to say this. I never understood the comparisons between Zeppelin and everything else. And I just wanted to throw that out there. For me, I think with Kingdom Come, that album was so different than anything that was coming out at that time. You sounded nothing like, I guess you could say, the hair bands that were coming out at the time. It was a completely different sound that took everybody by storm.
I mean, all I can say is thank you so very much for saying that, because that's exactly how we always felt. I think, you know, things are meant for a reason. And sometimes things may not look very peachy at a particular time, but it's just something you have to adapt to. But the bottom line is, I was static about three bands: the Beatles, Led Zeppelin, and God, what was the other band I was trying to mention?
Oh, AC/DC.
Hey, AC/DC, exactly. And we're talking early AC/DC, Bon Scott. So those three bands were played in my car, whose stereo system was more expensive than the car itself. Like, I mean, throughout my whole childhood, you know what I mean? So, and every artist, whether you're a painter or a musician or an architect or whatever the hell you are, whatever it has to do with art, you are, especially in your young days when you start off, are being influenced by something you like very much, or artists who you just admire. So, and right at that time when we recorded Kingdom Come, I was surrounded by a great band who admired the same style I was listening to, so it kind of summed up. Stone Fury had the exact same attitude and kind of red guidelines, if you want to put it this way, but nobody really like took note of it, because first of all, it wasn't very successful, and maybe that was it. I mean, and the main reason why it wasn't really heard very much, I don't know. But once Kingdom Come like took off and just broke the charts and went through the roof, people were more aware of like, oh, what's going on? And obviously, when you're successful, you have your fans, you have your friends, you have people who dig it, and you also have the smart asses and the jealous guys who don't like want to give you the bread for your butter, the butter on your bread. You know, it's one of those saying. I don't even work in the States, but it's a German saying.
Exactly.
But actually, I wrote a song. I think it's on the record called "Ain't Crying for the Moon." The song title is simply called Bon Scott. It's a tribute to Bon Scott. Obviously, I was digging deep into all the AC/DC stylistics, writing a song on my own, and just saying thank you for Bon. Thank you, Bon, for helping me through my childhood. So it's a tribute to Bon. And as you were mentioning it earlier, you know, obviously I covered "And I Love Her." "I'm Across the Universe," in a different style. But let me just take a step back now. I think the whole shitstorm started. At first, we were celebrated as like, oh, great, there's a band sounding more like blah, 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 with a bit more substance and got that great vibe and feel and groove. So, I mean, it started out very, very nice. But then we as the band got really tired of the constant comparisons. And I think it was doing one a dinner. We all sat together at a table. And Denny was just mentioning, I mean, just like sarcastically, ironically saying, who is Jimmy Page? I mean, just like a remark taken out of context. And some writer overheard it and wrote up Denny Stagg saying he never heard of Jimmy Page before, which, of course, it's so ridiculous. It's so unbelievable. And then you had the press, like, you know, jumping on the bandwagon, just doing anything for a headline to make an extra buck. So that's how the whole negativity and tons of tomatoes being thrown at us. That's how what happened. It's kind of a bummer, because I think the pressure, looking back at it today, kind of also led to an earlier breakup of the original lineup than we were hoping for. But again, now many, many, many moons later, everything is meant for a reason. No complaints from my end. I had the best time of my life. I'm thankful, grateful that I was able to do what I've been doing back then and what I am still able to do. So it is what it is. And all I can tell you guys out there, whether you're a musician or not, it's not all about money. And I mean it from the bottom of my tiny little German heart. Hallelujah.
Exactly. So basically what you're saying is just a constant criticism, knocking down the band and all that. Would you pretty much say that pretty much was the demise of the original lineup is what you're saying?
Yeah, I think the pressure kind of like, I mean, I just ran into James, like, I mean, we were playing in Russia several times. And Russia is a great market for us. I mean, the people are very emotional and great audiences. It's just one of those markets who works good. So, and the Scorpions, obviously, they are mega huge in Russia also. They're bigger than us, but they're like very, very big. So James has been playing with the Scorpions for the last, I don't know, 17 years now. And every so often when James run into each other, we look at each other asking ourselves, what exactly happened back then? And we both don't have a fucking answer. We don't know why we broke up. We just don't know. He's a very charming, clumsy but charming, wonderful guy. He's a great drummer. Unfortunately, I don't know if you heard about it, we were like talking about I hate the word reunion, but we were talking about doing something together again. I flew out to LA, and unfortunately when we just got together for our very first playing session, James fell off the chair. He wasn't doing good at all. I don't know exactly what substance this he took. I don't know if he has an alcohol issue. I don't want to point my finger. It's not my cup of tea, but he was not doing well. So working for the Scorpions, they are financially able to like put a personal babysitter aside for him. I can't do that. And the other thing is, which kind of like really bummed us out, Klaus didn't even give James the permission to work with different bands. So there I was, having flown in from Germany, Johnny, Danny, Rick, and myself all psyched up, ready to rock. And then a day later, oops, can't do it, guys. I mean, that was a real bummer, which really caused a lot of disappointment and hurt feelings. But despite all that, I still love James dearly. And again, it is what it is meant. Things are meant for a particular reason, which we can't always understand or adapt maybe in the future something will happen. But Johnny and Danny and myself decided to do something together again. So and that will of course include playing some of the old stuff again, you know. And I told Johnny and Danny already, listen guys, if you're gonna start playing together again, of course I would like to play a lot of the old stuff, because it's us, it's what made us, it's what we're all about. But you guys also please have to understand, I've been doing a lot of growing up throughout the last 24 years. And my music taste and my hearing habits and my writing habits and how I produce things has changed over the years. So, I mean, if you listen to songs like Twilight Cruiser, one of my all-time favorites, if I may say that in all modesty, songs you don't write every year, or Ain't Crying for the Moon, or Take Magnified, or Outsider, God Does Not Sing, our song from the latest record called Outlier, that's what I meant. Those are totally different approaches, but those stylistics and songs are as 100% Lenny Wolf as those old songs, whether 17, Get It On, or whatever Stone Fury song we're all about. So it's going to be a mixture of all of those particular, it's going to be like a time travel, like a journey through whatever, heaven and hell. Yeah, that's a good description. Yes.
I mean, I'm looking forward to actually having a chance to see you, hopefully here in the States. But I want to ask you this. You released In Your Face, and months after its release, you guys basically break up and dissolve the band. And before I get into the next stage of Kingdom Come, which I guess you could say is the Hands of Time and Forward, I guess one question I wanted to ask. You went from Stone Fury, which... that's a pretty kick-ass name for a band. How did you come up with the name Kingdom Come, or what's the story behind that particular name for the band?
honestly, I would love, I mean, I wish I was able to hit you with a very cosmic, holy, whatever answer. But the truth is, Marty Wolf, my former manager back then, he came up with the name Kingdom for whatever reason, I don't even recall. And it just popped out of me, come. And suddenly we were looking at each other, driving his Volvo, and like, Kingdom, come. Took us, I don't know, 6.5 minutes, and that was it. So sorry for all you hardcore believers or people who would have liked to hear some cosmic deep message behind it, but there is no deep thought. It's just, I do believe in a higher force. Some call it Jesus, some call it God, some call it Mickey Mouse, whatever. I believe in a kingdom, and I believe there's something going on, and I wish for the best to come. So, and may the kingdom for all of you guys and ourselves and my modern self come. I just like the vibe, and that's why we chose it, and that's how we ended up with it.
Now, let's move forward. I mean, you had mentioned wanting to work with a bunch of guys, being in the band setting. Okay, so the band dissolves, and then you come out with Hands Off Time, and you pretty much get rid of the whole band. The whole band's gone, and you pretty much do it all yourself. And for the most part, from this day forward, with a couple exceptions and a couple albums, you've pretty much been writing all the music, playing most of the music, and stuff like that. So how did you go from, hey, I want to be in a band, I want to be playing with a bunch of different people writing music, to, you know what, I'm going to do it my way, by myself? How did that come about?
I'm trying to be a very mature kind of a guy now, looking back at his past now. So I'm trying to give it some sense now. By saying that, I have to kind of analyze my personality to a certain degree, as much as I'm able to, whatever that means. But I think it has to do with several reasons. First of all, I'm a very distrusting guy. I came from the streets, always having to fight for whatever I want. I need a lot of harmony and peace surrounding me, and I feel threatened easily. And I've been through hell with especially the second Stone Fury record, and with the pressure, despite the wonderful success we were able to experience, it was still a lot of pressure I was not able to cope with properly at that time, because Kingdom Come did not have the chance to grow as a unit like AC/DC, Beatles, Led Zeppelin, to name them again, who were growing up together in the same city, speaking the same language, and were able to form a very strong unit, which is important to stand up against bullshit hitting you from the outside, which is always going to happen, whether you are very successful or just a little bit. It's just what happens. It's welcome to the music industry. So, and maybe at that time I reached a point where I figured, fuck it, I just gotta do it my own, and let's see what I can do. Looking back at it today, I think I produced records far too early. I should have taken on more advice, but the problem is finding the right advice from the right person at the right time, and that's the hardest part in life, because you're surrounded by smart asses 24 hours a day. Everybody knows it better. And Lenny, you should do this, you should do this, blah, blah, blah. And but I just had to put my foot down saying, no, I gotta do it this way. Hands Off Time, I'm kind of happy with. There are great moments on there. And then there are sections throughout the songs where I wish I would have done it differently. But, you know, again, it's a growing process. You gotta start somewhere. I didn't go to school like somebody teaching me how to record. What to consider. Everything you hear throughout the whole Kingdom Come records is just a very pure, like brutally pure, honest, kind of fragile writing with no manipulating or commercial interest whatsoever. And I truly mean it. Of course, it's great to have success. It's great to play like with houses being packed with people. But it was never my main drive or concern. It's writing songs is something, and that's why my records are also different, because I wasn't following a particular trend, trying to fit in or making money or making sure I could pay my rent. I never gave a fuck about being able to pay my rent. I had to satisfy myself on a musical level, not saying I reinvented the music, I certainly didn't, but it was like throughout the writing and recording process, it's a fight. It's like a direct hotline to the Almighty, giving me the signals to do what I have to do, and that's what it is.
Time of broad decay. The hand of fate is sick.